All right, take your Bible and join me in John chapter 19. This morning we're going to read about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. The more you examine the subject of the cross, the sacrifice of Christ, the more difficult it is for the world to deceive you. In Galatians chapter 6, in verse 14, the Apostle Paul wrote, "But God forbid that I should boast, except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world." In other words, one of the things that this verse means is that this fallen, sinful world is dead to us. It no longer seduces us, it no longer motivates us, it no longer causes us to fear. There are wonderful things in life, that's for sure, but our hearts are no longer set on this age, they're set on the age to come. So let's begin John chapter 19 and verse 17. "And he," Jesus, "bearing his cross, went out to a place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side and Jesus in the center. Now Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, 'Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews.' Then many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Therefore the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, 'Do not write, the King of the Jews,' but he said, 'I am the King of the Jews.' Pilate answered, 'What I have written, I have written.'" Now, we're told that the Hebrew word Golgotha means the skull. The Latin word is Calvaria, from which we get our word Calvary. You know, years I spent in vanity and pride, that song on Calvary. But the place of the skull still exists in Israel to this very day. It's a low mound with two large pits or holes on the side of it. And they look like eye sockets, and so that mound looks like a skull. The skull has always signified death, and I don't think it was an accident that Christ was crucified there. The wages of sin is death, and when Christ died for our sins, the ultimate power of death, sin, was defeated. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14 tells us that in the death of Christ on the cross, Christ destroyed or nullified Satan, who has the power of death. Sin is like, it's not only the cause of death ultimately, but it's like the concrete iron casket on top of you holding you down. Without redemption, sin would keep everybody dead. But because of the resurrection of Christ, he conquered sin and death, and so we are freed from that death. You should know that Golgotha is also the same area where Abraham was about to sacrifice Isaac. When everything was ready for the sacrifice, Isaac asked his dad, "Where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" And Abraham answered, "My son, God will provide for himself a lamb." And that's exactly what we're reading here in John chapter 19. That lamb is being nailed to a cross. With the sign that Pilate had made, usually the criminals wore that sign around their neck, and then when they were crucified, they took the sign and nailed it to the cross, and Jesus was being executed for being the King of the Jews. The sign was written in Hebrew and Latin and Greek, which were the major known languages of the world, and Pilate was using that sign to mock the Jews, but God wanted the whole world to know exactly why Jesus was being crucified. Verse 23. "Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece." This is, look at verse 24, sorry. Then they said, therefore, among themselves, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Therefore the soldiers did these things. This quote is from Psalm 22. It's amazing when you read Psalm 22 because it so graphically denotes a crucifixion, and it was written 1,000 years before this event, even before the Romans started practicing crucifixion as a tool of execution. When they took his tunic, that was all one piece, that was his undergarment. And so I think this makes it clear that when Christ was crucified, he hung there before the world, totally naked and exposed. Verse 25. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved, John, standing by, he said to his mother, Woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, Behold your mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. Jesus made 7 statements from the cross. The other gospels tell us that they were all uttered as a strange darkness was beginning to fill the sky. John only records 3 of those statements, one of which is for the care and concern of his mother. Despite his deep pain and agony, Christ was concerned for his mom. Joseph had most likely died, and so Jesus asks John to take care of his mother. There's an interesting scene in Matthew chapter 12 when Christ is teaching and his mothers and his brothers and his sister come to take him home because they think he's crazy. And so the crowds ask him about his mother and his sisters, and Jesus says this, quote, Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. In other words, believers are the family of God. And if Christ could be concerned about his mother while he's dying on a cross, then certainly we can be concerned about one another, even in our toughest moments of life. And Christ's words also show his willingness to care for you. If he was willing to die for our sins, certainly he lives now to intercede for us and to give us his grace and strength for all of life. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through whom? Christ. Through Christ. He lives now. He died for our sins, but he lives now to strengthen us and to help us in every possible way. John now recalls a statement that also fulfills scripture, but that reflects the great torment that Jesus was in. Verse 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. I looked this up. Thirst is one of the most agonizing of physical pains, especially when you're dehydrated. And think of this. Think of all the blood loss Jesus has incurred, plus all the liquid that he's lost through dehydration while being scourged and whipped and beaten. The agony that he must have faced must have been great indeed. Verse 30. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, It is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Many people have been crucified. Many people have died in horrible ways. But there has been no death like the death of Jesus Christ. And this is because his death was vicarious for us. He was our substitute. The phrase, it is finished, is one word in the Greek, but it's not the mumbling of a dying man. The point of that saying is an achievement has been made. It was a victorious proclamation. Ever since Genesis 3:15, where God promised a Redeemer, that work had been going on for thousands and thousands of years. And Jesus Christ, right before he died, said that lamb that Abraham offered for the sins of the world was now finally fulfilled in Jesus Christ. It was finished. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that God made Christ sin for us that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Galatians 3:13 and 14 tells us that on the cross, Christ became a curse for us so that we could receive the blessings of Abraham. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7 announces that we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins, through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Verse 31. Therefore, because it was the preparation day, that the body should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, Passover, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. They would break the legs of those crucified because the way you died on a cross was suffocation. And if you couldn't hold yourself up, then you couldn't breathe. And so that's why they did that. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. And he who has seen this has testified, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you may believe. For these things were done that Scripture should be fulfilled, not one of his bones shall be broken. And again, another Scripture says, they shall look on him whom they have pierced. What John wants us to understand are three things here. Number one, Jesus Christ's death was voluntary. He was not a victim. All through his life and even in death, he was aware of fulfilling Scripture. Secondly, God's will can be trusted to come to pass. God knows all things, even the end from the beginning. And so there is no more sure word in the universe than the Word of God. If you're looking for something to build your life on, you can build it on the Word of God. Third, Jesus really died. All of the theories about Christ not dying are lies. John says, I was an eyewitness. I was there. Even in death, Jesus was fulfilling Scripture. He actually died. And the Scripture about they'll look on me whom they will pierce, there's a prophecy in the Old Testament and also reiterated again in Revelation that there's a day coming when Israel and all the world will look at Jesus and mourn on him whom they have pierced. Verse 38. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission, so he came and took the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who had first came to Jesus by night, remember in John chapter 3 about being born again, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. Then they took the body of Jesus and bound it in strips of linen with the spices, as the custom of the Jews is to bury. You know what came to my mind when I read this? Do you remember the story just that really takes place just days before the crucifixion, where there's a dinner party for Jesus because of Lazarus being raised from the dead, and Mary anoints Jesus Christ for his burial? Everybody was really upset about that event, and Jesus says, leave her alone. What she's doing for my death and burial. Of all the people at the dinner party, Mary was the only one who really understood that Jesus was going to die, had to die. And she had often sat at the feet of the Lord and had taken in every word that he had spoken, and understanding that she might not be there to anoint him after death, she did it beforehand. It was an act of foresight filled with immense love. Mary didn't know that secret disciples, how would she know there were secret disciples? Mary didn't know there were secret disciples, and that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus would take care of the body of Christ. So she decided, I need to. So what do I take away from this? Like Mary, when it comes to acts of love, we should never wait to see what other people are going to do. God may have other plans, like he had Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus in his plans, but if God has put something kind and loving on your heart for you to do, do it. Don't wait, because you never know. Jesus never knew, because he was dead, that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus were going to tenderly care for his body. But he knew what Mary had done. Verse 41. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So there they laid Jesus because of the Jews' preparation day, for the tomb was nearby. It's interesting that John tells us that the tomb was in a garden not far from where the crucifixion took place. The cross represents sin and death and horror and shame. The garden was the place of resurrection and joy. We all want to be in a garden with the resurrection, but you can't get there without the cross. We have to admit that our sins were nailed to that cross. We have to believe that Jesus is whom God says he is, that he died for our sins. When that occurs, then we can say confidently what Christ has said. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my words and believes in him who sent me has passed from death to life. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word to us this day. Thank you for your grace and goodness to us. May we take heed to your word, and especially, Father, the example of Mary, who didn't wait for the opportune time to show that she loved the Lord Jesus, but did it before his death. May we often do what is good and kind and loving even before it's needed. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.